got the announcement?
Carolyn Honeycutt for 20
some years, and I thought, you know, how different it is that we cannot mourn the way we're used to mourning, you know, and it is, it's very sad, and I know that has to, if you're anyone that's lost a loved one, that has to hurt that much more. So continue to keep all those people in your prayers. Are there other people that you'd like us to add to the prayer list or anything? Nancy?
I'd like to pray for the people in Minneapolis.
Minneapolis.
Yeah.
And the rest of the country.
They need some peace.
Yes. Others? It's good to see everybody here this morning. It's always a wonderful and great day if we can be together in the house of the Lord. So I'll turn it over to Miles and Carter.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you join me in singing two verses of the Church's One Foundation? He knew what was going to happen, and he was going willingly. But he was still human like us, and that's the one thing I always like to remember. You know, he still had to dread what was coming, even though he went willingly to that cross. And as we take this bit of bread, we remember that he walked, prayed, and was one with his Father, with God, as we are. And when we come around the communion table, that's what we're remembering, is our oneness with Christ, our oneness with God and the Holy Spirit. And now, as Miles and Carlene play our hymn of communion, you can prepare your communion.
Thank you.
time around your table. We truly feel each and every week that our burdens are lifted when we are here. That your love surrounds us. We remember your son's great sacrifice on the cross. We remember that he gave his life for each one of us. He knew what we would do, and he gave his life for us. Father, as we take of this bread, we drink of this cup, we ask that you bless them and bless us as we go forward in your name. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. If you'll take your bread. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks for it, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, and he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and he blessed it and gave it to the disciples, and he told them, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink of it in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Us with. Father, we know that there are needy people in our world and in our community. Father, we know that there are always going to be situations that worry us, that concern us. But Father, the one thing that we know is that you are steadfast. You are with us always. You are our God, and we are your people. We thank you for that knowledge, and we thank you that we can be here together around your table, in your house, worshiping you and remembering the many things that you do for us each and every day. As we go forward in our worship service, please open our ears and our hearts so that we can hear your word. And as we go out into the world, please open our eyes and our mouths so that we can say and repeat your word to an unbelieving world. It's in your son's great name we make this prayer. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you. Greetings in the name of Christ our Lord. We are thankful that each of you are able to be here, and we want to be mindful of those that would delight in being here, but because of their health conditions and the threat of this pandemic, are unable to be with us. So we welcome those as well that are joining us by way of video for our morning worship today. Our worship service and the sermon is on the subject of temptation and what we might learn from temptation. Our scripture reading, of course, is taken from the Gospel of Luke, the fourth chapter, which suggests and means that this is during the early part of Jesus' ministry. And the scripture reads, as we read from Luke 4, beginning with the first verse and continuing through verse 13. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. And in those days he did eat nothing. And when they were ended, he afterward took hunger. And the devil said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, command this stone that it might be made bread. And Jesus answered him, saying, It is written that man should not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed him unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, All this power will I give thee, and the glory of them that is delivered unto me, and to whomever I will give it. If thou wilt worship me, all shall be thine. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. And he, meaning Satan, brought him to Jerusalem, and set him on a pinnacle of the temple, and said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from hence. For it is written, He shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou shalt dash thy foot against a stone. And Jesus answering said unto him, It is said, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And when the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season. Let us join together in prayer. God our Father, we thank you for the faithfulness of the church throughout the centuries. But we also thank you for the faithfulness of your Son, Jesus Christ, to his mission of saving the world. And in that, it required perfection. It required perfection at birth, and therefore he was born and conceived of the Holy Spirit. It required perfection in daily living, as he was tempted in like manner that we are tempted, but yet he sinned not. And so we thank you for his faithfulness under severe and difficult situations. And Lord, we pray today for the faithfulness of the church as we face the crises of our day. It seems like they unfold one by one before we even get through the first, the second is appearing. And so, Lord, we pray that you might strengthen your church, that you might make the church a faithful instrument of yours in this time when your witness is so desperately needed. So bless us, Lord, as we look to both today and the future as being representatives of yours in this world. We pray also for the many that in our community is in need of your divine intervention. We pray for those that are ill due to the coronavirus. We pray, Lord, for those who have lost jobs, Some have lost hope as they look to the future, perhaps uncertain about whether their jobs would ever return after this time of the virus lifts. We pray for the unrest in our nation. We pray that we might be sensitive to the needs of all people. We know that it certainly requires sensitivity as we deal in intense situations, one with the other. And so we pray that the conditions that has aroused protests and has aroused demonstrations, and in many cases lawlessness throughout our nation, that you might speak to the hearts of humanity, that they would hear from on high, and they would heed your word, for in it is not confusion, but in it is peace and joy and happiness. So bless us as we worship you this hour, for we ask all of this in the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen. We see Jesus in this picture returned to Jordan, and he is led by the Spirit out into the wilderness area. This is a desolate desert area that Jesus went to. There was the provisions of water, or Jesus could not have survived probably over 5 or 6 days at the most. Man can only go like 3 to maybe 6 days without water. And this was a hot, a dry climate that he was in there in the Holy Land. The scripture teaches us that Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit. This brings to mind the unity of the Godhead, that that God was in Christ. God was in the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit was in Christ. They were unified in spirit and in mission, and sometimes they differed a little in function, but all for one divine purpose. And so Jesus, being filled with the Holy Ghost, was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. How often do we yearn or pray for the leadership of the Holy Spirit? He is our comforter. He is a source of strength. Also, he is a revealer. He brings to our mind important information. And we also need to be led of the Spirit of God. Jesus, I'm sure, knowing the beginning from the end, was aware of what he was going into. But many times the Holy Spirit leads us into directions that we're uncertain about the practicality of it. The Holy Spirit may lead us into a situation where we can see no good coming out of it, but yet God makes everything right according to his will. We know that back shortly after Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection, there was a man in the midst of a great revival there in Jerusalem. And he just practically blinked his eye and looked around him, and instead of being in Jerusalem, he was down in the desert, down in Gaza. And as he looked around, he saw a cloud of dust in the distance. And perhaps he wondered why in the world God had translated him from Jerusalem down to this area. But he saw this cloud of dust becoming larger and larger, and eventually, a man came up in a chariot that was heading from north to south. He was on his way to Ethiopia. And this man was reading from the scripture from the book of Isaiah, this scroll he had rolled out. And so he was reading from the 53rd chapter of Isaiah. And so Philip said, "Understandest thou what thou readest?" And he said, "How can I, except some man show me?" So Philip climbed up into the chariot, rode along with him, and this man was converted. And he saw an oasis, a pond of water, and he said, "Here is water, what hindereth me to be baptized?" And Philip says, "If thou believest, thou mayest." And they went down into the water, and he baptized the Ethiopian eunuch, And so after the baptism, the eunuch went on his way rejoicing, taking Christianity south to the nation Ethiopia. He perhaps at that point could not see the importance of going down into the Gaza Strip, but yet the Spirit of God took him there. And so the Spirit of God has led Jesus into the wilderness. And the reason for his being into the wilderness was to go through several avenues of temptation. I like to think of the temptations that that he faced there. First of all, was food or physical appetite. The second was power. And the third temptation was fame. These are things that all operate in our world today, both on to the Christian and to the non-Christian alike. So he was being 40 days tempted of the devil. So it started out at day one. You know, sometimes when things are repeated to you over and over again, the first few times it's just sort of irritating. But can you imagine being confronted by the devil? And what in the world did the devil use to confront Jesus? He used Scripture. He quoted to Jesus proof text taken out of context. He was using Scripture to try to convince Jesus to sin in order that the whole world would then, from that point forward, would be condemned forever. But Jesus countered with Scripture that was in context. It had the meaning that it really should have at that moment of time. And so as he was being tempted for 40 days, he did eat nothing. So it doesn't say anything about him drinking. He drank water. And when they ended, he afterward hungered. Well, we all know what it's like to be late for a meal. If it's been 6 or 8 hours since we've eaten, unless you're sort of like me, I'm sort of like a camel. I eat rather large meals and I can go for a while. But a lot of people can't do that. They need meals on a regular basis where they feel hungry. So can you imagine going a whole day without eating anything? And then that night going to sleep and feeling some gnawing pain in your stomach. And then the next day you're back up. No food again, over and over again, day after day, with nothing to eat. We have learned a lot about long-range intentional fasting, even fasting unto death through the army of the Irish Republican Army of Northern Ireland back 30 or so years ago, as they were constantly waging guerrilla warfare against England and the United Kingdom with bombs. They blew up a lot of important people. They blew up one of the great heroes of World War II, Lord Mountbatten, who was an English hero, and he became knighted by the Queen, and they exploded a bomb and killed him. And once these members were captured one by one, many of them made a choice to not eat when they were in prison. And this continued usually into the high 50s or low 60-day count. And usually after days 52, 53, 54, 55, somewhere along in there, they arrived at a point that even if they started to feed them, they would still die. They had reached a point of no return. And so they fasted unto death. And so this is how, this was the point that Jesus was at 40 days. He was very weakened, no doubt, with lots of weight loss and probably people who knew Jesus before he entered the wilderness experience and saw him coming out of the wilderness experience would have hardly recognized him because he had lost so much weight. And here he was at a vulnerable point in life. You know, it's interesting, the devil usually doesn't come to us in strong moments when we're feeling good about ourselves, feeling good about the world surrounding us. But it's when the circumstances of life often beat us down and we're at our weakest point, this is when he tries to make an entry into our lives. And so he went and spoke to Jesus. All of this dialogue appears to happen after the 40 days. Jesus had went through this, and now Satan pulls out the big guns to use against Jesus. First of all, with food. We have seen lots of images of people on desert journeys and so forth that have been without water, and they begin to have mirages. They see oases, they see palm trees in the future, which in the distance, and they feel like, well, there's water, and they become excited about it. And once they arrive there, it's just more desert. And so Jesus, when Satan described making bread, I have a feeling that he used vivid language. He made that bread look just as good as possible. Good old homemade bread. And a nice crust on it, fresh. Everything was just ideal. And all that Jesus would have to do is speak to a stone and turn that stone into bread. Well, God fed the children of Israel with manna in the wilderness. There was all kinds of reasoning that could be used to just take that step and make that stone into bread. But Jesus was able to see Satan in the process. He knew that this was a position of compromise. And so Jesus then stated the truth from the scripture. He says, it is written, man should not live by bread alone, but every word of God. The actual Old Testament scripture says that the man should not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. So God's word was the guide for Jesus Christ. And so what are we? We're disciples. We're followers of Jesus. So if we follow his example, his word is the illumination of our pathway. It gives us a sense of direction, what way we ought to move, and what we ought to be doing with our lives. And so Jesus said to Satan, bread is not the most important thing in life. Man should not live by bread alone, but every word of God. So many of us in our modern day have looked about things that we want to purchase and we want to buy, and every opportunity for overtime and work, we capitalize on that. Time and a half, double time. Well, it might be our kids' birthdays, but that's all right. I'll make up for it afterward. I'll get them toys later in the week. I'll get them something for their birthday. And so we put other things before the important things of life. And so Jesus says that just sustaining ourselves with bread or indulging ourselves with feasting or whatever is not the way to peace and joy and happiness, but by heeding the word of God, every word of God. So the devil's taken back for a moment, but he quickly recovers. And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. This was miraculous, to be able to see around the whole world in a moment of time. And then Satan says, if you'll just fall down and worship me, I'll give you everything that you see, the whole world. The scripture tells us, what would it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? Jesus understood the word of God. Jesus understood the value system of God. What is really important is not who is sitting on the Father's right hand or left hand. That's what three of his disciples sought after. Lord, when you come into your kingdom, would you grant to my brother the privilege of sitting on your left hand and me sitting over on your right hand? You know, we've been with you a year and a half here now, so we ought to be given a little recognition when we get there. And Jesus said, you don't know what you're asking for. Because Jesus was going to be sitting at the right hand of the Father, and God was at his left hand. And they were asking even for the position that God was sitting in. So sometimes we lose our sense of value along the way. And so the devil said, look at all of this stuff. All of this could be yours if you are just willing to follow me, if you're willing to fall down and to worship me. And this was an offer of power. He said, all this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will give it. So the devil tells a lie here. And the scripture describes him this way. He says that Satan is a liar, and he's the author of a lie. And so he isn't backed by the truth. Whatever he has to tell in order to get his way, Satan is willing to do this. And Satan is a very powerful figure. He's called the prince of the air and the prince of this world. But he's not king. You know, Jesus is king over the earth. Satan couldn't give Jesus something that he already owned. He said that the cattle upon 1,000 hills belongs to me. That was Jesus' inheritance. That was Jesus' possession. So Satan was promising something that he could not give. So many of the enticing things that Satan offers to humanity are mirages. They're pipe dreams. They maybe look good on the near horizon, but in the distance, they will fail. And so as he offers this to Jesus, he says, if thou will just worship me, all these things will be thine. And Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. The first commandment brings to light our responsibility to God. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul and all thy strength. And the second is likened unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And so Satan was trying to coach Jesus in a vulnerable time of his life as he was beaten down by hunger and isolation and heat from the desert. And you could just imagine, you know, it's hard for us to understand what it's like to be in the desert. But in the daytime, it's extremely hot. But when the sun goes down, the desert gets to be a cold place. And I'm sure that Jesus just had the clothing that was on his back. And so you're talking about vulnerability. And Jesus was a man of like passions as we are. He had all the perceived needs that you and I have. Cold affected him. Heat affected him in his human form. He was subject to all the things that we are, but yet he sinned not. And so Satan then makes one last stab at him. He takes him into Jerusalem, the seat of Jewish religion. It actually is the birthplace of all the monotheic religions of the world. We have three religions that are monotheist. That is the Jewish religion, the Christian faith, and the Muslim faith. They all three believe in one God, and so many others are believers of multiple gods, a God for this thing and that thing and the other thing. And so he takes him there to this pinnacle of world religion, really, and takes him up on the pinnacle of the temple so everybody can see him. And so if he just leaps off the pinnacle of the temple, why, he can just float right down to the ground, just like he ascended up to heaven. The disciples watched him on the Mount of Ascension. When he ascended back to heaven, he just slowly went back up into heaven. And what an impression this would make on all the people. Showmanship. You know, he could show the world who and what he was. Cast yourself down from the pinnacle of the temple, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee. This is a quotation from the Psalms. And in the Psalms, he said that he would give his son 10 legions of angels. That's 10,000 angels. And we sing that song sometimes about 10,000 angels. He had 10,000 angels that accompanied him at the crucifixion and in the wilderness experience. But the angels were merely spectators there. They didn't feed him. They didn't minister to him. Jesus was basically on his own, but he felt the presence of the Holy Spirit, and he felt the presence of God there. And with this, he was able to march through these temptations. Well, why in the world did Satan promise him money? For the scripture tells us that the love of money is the root of all evil. So why wouldn't money use this as this? These are all the kinds of things that money will buy. Power, fame, recognition, being recognized and so forth. And so Satan wasn't going to give him the money to purchase this. He was just going to give these things to him. And so today, as we seek our goals, the thing that we often seek is money so we can buy feelings. That's what these kind of things give to us. But feelings are a fading sensation. We may get up in the morning and we may feel fantastic, but something that happens during the day can suction that right out of our lives. So our feelings change. And you can buy material things and you think, boy, that's going to make me happy. Can't you remember as a child, as you thought about what you wanted for Christmas, and you dreamed up this fantastic thing, if you could just get this for Christmas, it was going to bring you happiness. It was going to make your day for you. And Christmas morning, it was an exciting time. Well, how was that 2 weeks later or 4 weeks later? Other things have become more important. And this has sort of lost its meaning. But salvation, the presence of God through his Son, Jesus Christ, being in our lives, is a perpetual source of strength and peace and satisfaction. The Jews used the Hebrew word shalom as they talked about peace. It was a greeting. That's what they, instead of saying, hello, how are you today? They said, shalom, peace to you. And this was not the kind of peace that meant an absence of warfare, but this was an inner peace that brought to you joy and satisfaction day after day. It's the kind of peace that money can't buy, fame can't buy for you. Many people don't have a lot of material possessions, but they're the happiest people in the world. And so as Jesus was given this promise of the protection of angels, if he cast himself down from the temple, Jesus answered and said unto him, it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Well, we've had a lot of opportunities to do that during this pandemic. Some people say, well, we ought to just all gather at the church and pack the church full and everything is going to be all right because our faith is going to carry us through. Well, Jesus could have cast himself off the pinnacle of the temple, and his angels would have borne him up. He would not have dashed his foot against a stone, but he would have surrendered to Satan. And so we don't step out in front of a freight train and say, well, I'm a Christian and the Lord's going to protect me from that freight train. But sometimes in the midst of the risk that we take and with a physical illness like this, we seem to think that we ought to test God. Up in West Virginia, not too far from my home, in McDowell County, that is the center of snake handling in the world. The real capital was Juneau, West Virginia, and they got their cages with copperheads and rattlers, and this was a test of their faith. But I always followed the advice of my dad. He said if he meant for us to handle those things, he'd have put a handle on them. So I've never found a handle on a snake, so I don't need to pick one of those up to test my faith. Satan tests my faith daily in different ways, and he tests your faith. Satan knows our vulnerability. You know, he started out with our first parents, with tempting them in a way that was that he knew that he could be successful. That was Eve, and he knew that the appeal of sight, you know, seeing something beautiful, was attractive to him. You know, somebody can have some beautiful flowers or something, and I can walk right by them and sometimes not notice them for days or weeks. But women tend to look upon things of beauty and focus on and recognize them. And so Eve looked at the fruit, and Satan said, look how beautiful it is. Do you think something that beautiful can really be harmful to you? In the day that you eat of this, you will not die, but you will be as gods. You'll be able to know good from evil, and all knowledge will be given to you. And so he described it in such a way, he's a super salesman. He described it in such a way that that she said, yes, I'm going to try it. Sort of like the old fella on the freight train. There was a couple of hobos back in the 30s riding the freight train. And they got back there in this boxcar, and they found a bunch of bananas. And they broke off a couple of these bananas from the boxcar. And one of them said to the other, said, these must be bananas. You know, we heard about them, but I've never had a banana in my life. You know, imported fruit in the 30s and in the Depression. The other guy said, well, I haven't either. He said, well, I wonder what they did to you to eat them. And he said, they really look good. They smell good. And he said, I don't know. And one of them said, well, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to take a bite of banana. And so about the time he took a bite of banana, this freight train entered the tunnel. And all of a sudden, everything got completely black. And he said, whatever you do, don't bite that banana, because I did and I went blind. So sometimes we don't know what the consequences of taking ventures like that can do for us. And so Eve took a bite of the fruit, and she took it to her husband, Adam, and said, Adam, here's this fruit. It's beautiful to look at, tastes good, so on and so forth. So rather than being intrigued by sight of the fruit, his wife was more convincing than even Satan could be. Satan worked through this new servant that he had captured for himself. And so he also took of the fruit because they were both convinced by Satan. And so Satan is still at work. Sort of like the lady that was always complimentary of people in her neighborhood. Some people was always coming to her and saying, well, have you heard what Sister So-and-so down the road did last week? And she'd always find something good to say about it. So finally they said, well, we're going to stump her. And they came to her and they said, well, tell us, what good can you tell us about Satan? And she said, and she thought about it a while, she said, well, he's always on the job. And so that's certainly true. In our world today, the way in which he appeals to us is different than in past generations. but it's just as strong, or it may be even stronger, because in the latter days, his power and his influence is going to become greater. But there is the one who is greater than he is. He that is within you is more powerful than he that is within the world. And you can't do like Flip Wilson and say, well, the devil made me do it. No, he tempted you, but you yielded to temptation. All the temptation comes from within inside of us. And a good super salesman talking to a salesman talking to a salesman.